time to completely step it up, to time to now do something which is breaking from format completely from what we've been doing for the rest of the day and what has been happening before this. It's time to mix it up. So what we're going to do is we're going to take retail and reality shows and we're going to mix it up. So one of the names that comes to me for this is a retality show, but I don't know if it sounds right. But we will be doing something along the lines of that. So what is it that we're going to do? This is something we've been doing for many years now. It's called the Tommy Hilfiger Rising Star Challenge. Some of the most talented young minds from business schools. So we take some of the best business schools, the minds from there, the raw creative talent, the innovation that they have, which is untested and untried in the real market, and we actually throw it into what a market really needs, new thinking for retail. We give out a challenge. It is a completely reality show style. We throw out a challenge, and we expect them to come up with the solutions for current problems that the retail infrastructure and the retail industry is going through. How big is it? How do we really come to it? Well, let me just give you a few statistics. So the challenge was given out to 300 plus business schools. 300 plus business schools participated. They all came out with their way of coming out with solutions. So what was the challenge and what do we expect? So the Rising Star Challenge invites India's top business schools teams to suggest a retail business plan with the most innovative and unique use of new media and technology for seamless omni-channel retail. Idea should reflect a marriage of technology, behavioral science, a creative idea to fully immerse the customer at every touch point, and it must be having some connection with reality. It can't be a fantasy plan. So like I said, 300 plus business schools actually came out with plans, and only three of them have made it to the final. I will announce the finalists just in a short while. Right now I'm going to tell you exactly some of the business schools that participated were ISB Hyderabad, IIM Ahmedabad, IIM Bangalore, SIBM Pune, XLRI, IIM Kolkata. So pretty much the best of the best, 300 of them, and three of them have now made it to the final. So what happens now? This is what happens. We have a fantastic jury. We have the three finalists. I'll just tell you the rules and why it's a reality show. So all of it happens right now, right here on this stage. From each team that has made it, three people will come in here and present their business idea, whatever medium they want to use, PPT, otherwise they're open to do what they like. They get a total of 15 minutes. I'm going to be very strict about the 15. So at 12 and at 14, I will actually tell them. At 15, it's a complete shutdown. Wherever you are in your presentation and your business strategy plan, you get shut down. I will not give you more than 15 minutes. 5 minutes after that, two questions from the jury, one question from all of you in the audience is what they actually have to answer. So I will come to you for questions within that. So I'm going to call in first my jury, and then I'll call in and announce the three finalists. So our grand jury comprises of Shailesh Chaturvedi, CEO Tommy Hilfiger. Shailesh. Okay, that could be an interesting start. We don't have a first jury member. So that would be interesting after all the strictness of 15 minutes and all of that. All right, can somebody find Shailesh while I carry on? Yeah, okay. Bijoy Kurian, member, Strategic Advisory Board and mentor. L Capital Asia, hi. So we're going to do this informally as possible. We'll get you to take one of these, yes. Bhavik Javeri, founder and CEO of Preta. Oh, Ankur is coming in, okay. So, is he on his way? Oh, it is Ankur, okay, sorry. Okay, great, man, I'm doing really, really well with this one. It's more a stand-up comedy than a reality show for sure. Okay, the third one is me, so I'm pretty much here and I won't really get my name or identification wrong for sure. So I'm going to be on the grand jury too, but it's more for getting the format right than anything else. So let me now introduce the three B schools that have finally made it. It is a big deal. 300 plus actually present, only three make it. And this is what we have for us as the three B schools. It's IIM Bangalore, ISB, and Wellinkers. All three here, right? Okay, so we have them here. We will start with ISB. You'll be first. Is that the... So you're going to start off first? Is that how we... So you do have the other two teams here, right? Other teams right here. Okay, great. Okay, so like I said, I'm going to just repeat the rules quickly for you again. Mainly, I'm trying to waste time so that Shailesh comes, but we'll still get you to the rules again. So it's 15 minutes strict on that time. We'll shut you down at 15. Two questions from the jury, one from the audience. Question from the jury also is not going to be analysis. It's going to be a straight question, short, and I'd like your answer to be the same also, as short as possible. You have a total of 5 minutes to actually get through the three questions. We will mark you on that basis, right? So I'm going to invite IIM Bangalore to be the first. Three of you, your 15 minutes will start, including your introduction. Who is, out of the three people, did you play any specific roles? What did each person come up with? Introduce yourself, what you did, and you've got started, all right? So let's give them a big hand. Finalist number one, IIM Bangalore.
Can we have the slides, please? Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are here representing IIM Bangalore, as Rajiv said, the three of us from the EPGP program. Myself, Sugam Bagla. I have Rahul Agarwal here with me and Santosh Mishra. Let's jump straight into the plan. This is what feels makes us exciting. So my pleasure, of course, here to present before you our business plan for this team, which we call Team Gatik. All right. At the outset, I'd like to also introduce to you our offering, which is what we call Kalptaru. So you'll hear Kalptaru quite throughout the presentation. It's what we call our offering, just a name, right? We've selected a very colorful industry as far as this business plan is concerned. You'd probably imagine using the slide, it's pretty colorful. And what we've selected is Indian handlooms and handicrafts. So this is the industry that we've selected. And what we are here to present, of course, is the omni-channel retailing strategy for this particular industry. So let's jump straight in. Right? So before we deep dive, let me give you a sneak peek into what our offering is. We love watching trailers before we watch the movie, right? So this is more of a trailer. So why handlooms and handicrafts, first of all? Let's look at this. This is an industry which is growing domestically at a CAGR of about 18%. Pretty attractive, at least to me. And then you have about $250 billion of volume globally. I think that's a big pie, a good industry to target. Why are we that you know why? Given this, what is it that we as Team Gatik plan to do? No prizes for guessing, implement the omnichannel strategy. We've heard so much about omnichannel, that being the buzzword, that being the thing. Why should handlooms and handicrafts be left behind? We as Team Gatik firmly believe that the way to go forward for this particular industry is omnichannel. Also, what we propose to do is integrate the state handlooms, the state cooperatives. Right now, they work in a very disintegrated manner. There are issues that come with it. So what we also plan to do is integrate all the state-owned cooperatives. Given this why and the what, the obvious question you might have is, how, Sugam, do you plan to do this? So the first thing is, how can we deliver a personalized product that helps build a customer loyalty and a connect? Again, terms you would have probably heard a lot in the last 2 days, but it really is about that. For your business plan to succeed. How do I deploy IT to enable this transformation? We'll answer that. How do I understand my customer connect? How do I connect with my customer to create that wow? Very important, right? And then finally, how do I fulfill the wish of my customer to connect with the artisans? Now, some of you might feel handicrafts and handlooms, why do you want to connect the customer to the artisan? Is it important? Believe me, it is. Why is it? We'll answer that. Just hold on. Very quickly, the agenda. So given this, we've structured the PPT in this way. The first is handlooms. So we'll give you where the industry stands currently, what are the issues, what is being done for that. The next is the Kalptaru business plan. So given all that, what are the various facets of our business plan? We're going to present that. And finally, what is it that the Kalptaru experience is all about? So what is the customer going to see when we implement our plan? What is the future state going to be? So we give you a sneak peek into that as well. So once we selected the handlooms and handicrafts industry, the very first thing that we did was get down on the floor. We spoke to a lot of people, try to understand what exactly is this industry like, right? So what are the pain points? What are we dealing with here? Coincidentally, we were in South Korea for one of our immersion programs. We speak to Vikram. We spoke rather to Vikram. Vikram is our honorable ambassador to South Korea. A very, very educated, a very good guy, of course. IFS, Stevens, lots of positive things about it. We shared our idea, that this is our idea. We plan to do it for handlooms and handicrafts. What do you feel? Where does it stand? And he was very, very positive about it. It was literally a resounding yes, as you can see from the quote. What we did next was go and establish a connect with the consumer. We want to understand, why does a consumer go and buy these products, right? We feel that there are issues with it. Why do they still go? So we went to some of the major hubs of handlooms and handicrafts in the country, a couple of them, spoke to the consumer itself. The main point why the consumer still buys, because that's where they feel that there's a connect. They feel that this is their way of giving back to the artisans, maintaining our heritage, because that's central to this industry. So, given this, is it all hunky-dory? Do we have any issues? Do we have any challenges? Answer is yes, of course. So what are the challenges that we're looking at? Once again, we visited Wardha, which is where a lot of artisans are based, spoke to the artisans, try and understand what are their issues. The biggest thing that comes out, first of all, is the quality issues. So if I look at, say, two kurtas produced by the same artisan, you will find a disparity. Might be a minor one, but if you look at it, if you give to a QC guy here, he'll point it out, right? So there's inconsistency. Then, of course, there's a huge irregularity of the supply of raw materials, right? And why is that? Let's face it, we produce cotton very well. You look at the Vidarbha belt, there's a lot of cotton there. Why then are we not able to produce and give the raw materials on time? The answer is financial clout. The state cooperatives do not have the financial power to basically pay all the farmers. And that's another major issue that we are here to tackle with. Given this, we know that we have issues. It's a neglected industry. What is our government doing? Is it doing anything at all to revive this industry? So again, the answer is fortunately yes. There are a few key focus areas that we feel the government is focusing on. The first, as I said, is the availability of working capital, very, very important, and raw material as well. How? By using a cluster-based approach. We spoke to GoCoop. Now, GoCoop, interestingly, some of you might know, GoCoop operates a B2B kind of a marketplace where they are selling a very, very short product mix of only handlooms, right? So we spoke to the founder of GoCoop, which is Mr. Devi Reddy, very learned guy again. What he says is he's seen these changes, he's seen these measures by the government making an impact on the sector, which is very important. And if you look at it, it's pretty evident, isn't it? We have Mr. Modi coming on and announcing that we'll have a National Handloom Day on the 7th of August. So it shows that the government feels it's important to give some weightage to the sector. Very quickly, we know that things now, there are issues, it's sorting it out. Are we really sure the industry is good? We were perceptive. So we go back and see what does the industry look like. So we do the famous Porter's Five Forces analysis. Looks a moderately attractive industry. Makes sense to enter this at this point of time. And finally, let's look at the numbers. You see here, production going at a CAGR of 18%, consistently if you notice, which is important. Expected exports from India, 6 billion in the next 2 years. I think that's a major pie that's up for grabs, right? So I feel personally, or rather as Team Gatek, it's a very good industry, very attractive to enter into. Rahul, how do you plan to leverage this?
I think that we have already found out that the industry is pretty attractive, and so we should go all out and try to figure out what would be the product mix for all this. So we'll be going to target to the clothes market, to the furnishing, the furniture, and the jewelry market. So now the thing is, on the left-hand side, if you see on the screen, basically that's the product categorization for the online space, and the right-hand side, we are focusing onto the stores as well. Because without the stores, it's very difficult to reach out to the customers when the customers are specifically tourists and other people. So onto the right-hand side, we are going to target things like we are going to categorize our products based on location, the margins, the volume, and the life cycle of the product. So moving on to the marketing, how we are going to market this thing. So we want to be the who's who in the luxury brand, in the luxury segment, because I think there is a huge scope. If you take the example of Padma Shri, Mr. Raghunath, he has carved out a unique space for himself, for his artifacts, and he's charging really high price points in this particular segment. Now moving on to the partnership, because as when we talk to Mr. Vikram, who is the ambassador, so he told us when we go out in the market and try to look at the markets, so it's very difficult to find out what goes into the specific market or what not. So it's very good to, if we can partner it well across the globe. And so we have figured out that the 10% of the budget would be given to the marketing, and 80% of that would be through online channel. So moving on to the price point, so obviously we'll be doing the value-based pricing, which is the value-based pricing proposition, and the prices would be consistent throughout all the channels. But then how we are going to differentiate ourselves in all the other channels, like if you talk of online, from the retail, the brick and mortar store, so it's going to be through promotions. So let's try to make a differentiation from the operations point of view when we are going to create a customer experience, unique customer experience, by focusing on to integrating the supply chain, then on to the creating the checking, keeping a check on the quality of the products, using IT as an enabler for us. So this is how we are going to pan across India slowly and steadily by 2020. But so where we are going to source the product, that's one of the biggest questions, because Sugam has raised that quality is one of the issues. But if we just go through the list, there are a lot of national award winners, and Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, there are a lot of people who have actually got the awards. And these people are producing some really pretty goods and products, which we can just target very upfront and bring to the market. So if you just see, by just targeting seven states, we'll be able to catch hold of almost 80% of the products and the market. So let's try to understand how the number goes. So on the left-hand side, it's the how we are going to set up our distribution channel. But going on to the financials, actually on the very first year, we are trying export of $11 million. You might think these people are like kidding, and we are sitting over there, and $11 million seems to be a big number. But it's hardly 2.5% of what we are currently exporting from India. And I think being a good retail player, if you are able to price it well, it's not a big deal. So we are making a margin of just 6% in the very first year, but it's going to grow up to 26% as we slowly improve onto the margins and onto the, as we get more sales. So, but we are growing at a CAGR of 15%. So we haven't, okay. Growing at a CAGR of 15% and inflation is 5%. And looking right into the income from the domestic market, the thing is, like, we are taking 2 years to break even. We are starting from West Bengal, but by 2020, actually, we will be able to make a sales of $80 million and a profit of $20 million. So I think IT is one of the biggest things what can be done, and Santosh will take us through that particular piece.
Yeah, so the theme of the presentation, omnichannel. So what is omnichannel? So it's order from anywhere, fulfill from anywhere. So as a brand, Kalpataru, how does it plan to do it? So what we plan to do it is have some changes in our store operations, have mobile POS, kiosk. In the e-commerce space, we have something called Minicart, Locker, Cross-Sell, Recommendation. In the mobile app space, we want to start an app. We also want to have some very basic features like app locator, item locator, store locator, and all that stuff. So how do we do it? Technology, of course, the enabler. So how do we plan to leverage the technology? 3 steps. First one, we upgrade the IT infrastructure. Second one, we collect the data, aggregate the data. The third one, we look at 4 things, the order management, the inventory management, the customer management, as well as the channel management. So some of the innovations, I think Shailesh is here. So some of the innovations that the industry players have already brought in that, you know, significantly improves the customer experience are listed there. So coming to the experience, so it's all basic, right? So what's our USP? How do we sort of enhance the experience? We do not only want the customer to love the brand, we want them to live the brand. So how do we do it? So we'll have RFID, we'll have something called Artisan Connect, the customer can connect to the artisans that's building the product. We'll have something called personalization. He walks into a store, he wants to find out how to personalize his or her furniture, hand loom. You can have a 3D assisting modeling. Yeah, sure. Do-it-yourself zone. So we also want the customers to engage themselves. So somebody can walk into the DIY zone and then sort of start or his or her sort of handloom or handicraft. And then, of course, you also want to know about the product story. So once you buy the product, you want to know how the product was made. So we give them that experience. Finally, our high-level roadmap. How do we plan to do it? So we start with 2016 by having 19 stores in West Bengal. Then 2017, we have an expansion to 4 more states. We basically upgrade the infrastructure and have some innovations done in to execute the omnichannel strategy. Then 2018, we expand to 15 more states and then again bring in some innovations to improve the customer experience. And by 2019, we become the nation's number one player in terms of handicraft and handloom, and we go all out in terms of innovations. So next time you think of handicraft and handloom, think Kalpataru. Thank you.
So two things that they did very well. They finished on time and also they got some specific brownie points. Always good to have the person who's sponsoring this particular segment, their name out there on the slide. Always makes sense.
So I hope great, Shailesh, please.
Great brownie points. You know, you went really quickly. So if you missed it, I just want you to know that they had Tommy Hilfiger right there. Yeah, you should have stopped at that one saying technical problem, can't go forward. Okay, so good. Brownie points both in. You didn't lose points for time. You made extra points. Shailesh will give you some extras for sure. Okay, so two questions from the jury, quickly for them. Short questions that they can get short answers in, then I'll go to audience for one last one. Anything?
So what I see from this is still more like a inventory-based model, right? Where you source products, you buy them, and then you resell it, right? Doesn't it make sense being in omnichannel and handloom, talking so much about industry, connecting the dots directly, the last artisan gets benefited out of this. So I still see this as making up an own brand and then expanding to stores and have their e-com portals and then connecting the dots rather than connecting the dots right away at that first stage itself.
So actually, I'll try to answer this question. So,
Mike.
I guess we have, let's take the case of West Bengal. So we have 257 clusters over there and we have not had the time to take you through that. But we have also planned to appoint the cluster officers over there. So each cluster officer will take care of the 14 artisans, who will not only be the responsible person for sourcing, but also take care that the back end things is going on. Because it's a continuous process of continuous improvement process. So it can be done in one day, but obviously we'll start ahead with the players who are actually producing the quality goods. But then obviously we have to revive everything as it goes on.
And to further his answer, so when you talk of omnichannel strategy, we're looking at a customer standpoint. So there's handicraft, handloom. So obviously there are state cooperatives that the customer goes to and then buys the product. There are online players, but they do not support commerce. So our whole intention was to, you know, aggregate all the state coops that are there and then also have an online platform that's also an aggregation. And we also have mobile platform, as I spoke about. So once a customer comes in, he sort of doesn't see a difference between the store, the online, the M. So, you know, ultimately, it creates a seamless experience for the customer as far as handicrafts and handlooms are concerned.
All right. The second question from jury.
Just one question. You seem to have an entry strategy for domestic market starting with West Bengal. Any specific reasons why you selected West Bengal as your launchpad?
Sir, I think the reason we select West Bengal is primarily if you look at, can we go back on that slide, please? Okay, so the reason we select West Bengal is because that's where the most population of artisans is, which means that that's where most of the production hub is. Given that the production hub is in West Bengal for a reason, right? Because there's a market already there. So target the market there, target a market with volume first. So that's the reason we start with West Bengal. And it's not just going to be there. So we are going to add 4 states which have a very high market ratio of promise. So we just...
And also, there is one more point. If you take the case of West Bengal, I guess the Bengali families are the most culturally rich families. Okay.
Any these Bengalis are the people...
I'm not a Bengali, yeah. So that doesn't tickle me.
That's not going to get you brownie points.
No, but Bengali here.
That's actually true. So if you want early adopters of your things, so I guess it's one of the very good states to begin with.
But many would say that usually you don't start with something. The hub may be there for manufacturing, But most people would be very well aware of all products because it's locally available. It's where the product has never come out, where the markets may be larger. So that could be one thing that you could re-strategize on. Okay, I'm going to come with any follow-up to that? You're good?
See, in your presentation, there are a lot of slides on what will you do, right? I often ask my team and youngsters like you, when you build this brand called, let's say, Kalpataru, what are the two things you will not do? Because, you know, when you create something, it should be very clear as to what you will do and what you will not do. So tell me two things you will not do.
The first thing, we're very clear on who we are targeting. We're not targeting everybody and anybody.
Only targeting Bengalis, net worth individuals.
The niche segment. We're only targeting the niche segment. We're not targeting all the segments. So that's first thing that we'll not do.
Second thing is we are not going to play price war at any point in time, because as the example which I gave, if I just take any painting which he has developed, it's being sold at 1.5 lakhs to 2 lakh rupees in the market. And the Konark wheel which he develops, it's sold at 35 lakh rupees, and which it takes around 10 artisans to build and in a month's time. So I guess there is a margin of more than 500% if somebody is able to build it up. So it's all about how you are able to craft the whole market. How
so we don't get into a price war, basically.
So you expect a 35 lakh transaction online, right? You expect a 35 lakh transaction on your e-commerce store.
No, I think
store.
They said omni-channel.
So on the exports market, actually, we can target it. And somewhere we have also told that we are going to do a collaboration with already set up players across the world. That's going to give us some more platform and a channel to sell our products.
Okay, one quick question from the audience. Please dazzle us with one really good one. Okay, right in the front. He's right here.
So in this segment, already the GoCo is doing very well. No, that is, he's connected to almost all the cooperative societies in India.
So GoCo currently operates, we spoke to him, I think he currently operates in 3 of them. So he's with Maharashtra and I think a couple of other states that he said. The catch is he's only targeting B2B at this point of time. Our focus is B2C channel. So, you know, that's our differentiator. He has no plans of entering into B2C at this point of time.
Right, it's more of an online marketplace, if you can say Amazon for handicraft. So GoCoop doesn't do what we sort of had proposed.
And also the product points, if you go to GoCoop website, is entirely different from what we are targeting.
It might be the same category,
but the products are entirely
different. A very limited catalog.
So there are dozens of e-commerce sites are there. They're specially dealing in very niche for the niche market. And they're very well connected to the customers also, that is. If any order is placed, because they're well trained and they know, they have the experiences.
I think our whole strategy was, yes, niche segment, no price war, but we want to target everything and anything across all states, all handicrafts, handlooms. So that's one platform wherein you get handicraft from Odisha, Bengal, Tamil Nadu. So our strategy is to get handicrafts, handloom across all states. The high net worth individual is able to shop either at store or online all the products. So I know there are players that do specific or target niche segments in terms of product, but we are completely going all out.
All right, I think that is pretty much it. Very impressively done. Quite a few boxes tick marked out there for sure. So thank you so much. Let's give them a big hand.
Thank you.
Who's up next? Okay. So next up, like I said, more than 300 business schools. Next up, second finalist is ISB. Come. Hi. So I have to say, all through IRF, one of the things that, of course, is dramatically different from anything else is, of course, the very apparent ratio problem out here. Way too many men, very less women represented. So you guys are doing a great job already. I would advise you, the one male, to be more or less silent all through. If you can sit down behind one of these, hide away, these two will anyway get mega points. We see very few women on stage. So are you leading the presentation? She is, okay. You're starting well. All yours, 15 minutes.
A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see on the screen, we call ourselves the Retrail Blazers. We want to identify ourselves as the innovators or the trailblazers in the retail world. The three of us, Ankita, Kamal, and Akanksha, myself, have a cumulative industry experience of about 20 years in retail planning, customer relations, analytics, designing, and digital marketing. Our mentor, Professor Ahmed Timami, who is sitting in the audience, has a PhD in marketing with a focus on retailing. All right. So this was about us. Let us move on to the customer and the market. While our customer wants to be delighted with a seamless experience, our market is growing. The retail sales in India are set to reach $1.2 trillion by 2018 with a compounded annual growth rate of 14%. Not only the overall retail scenario, the e-commerce is growing. It currently represents 1% of retail sales, but is growing at an average rate of 45% per year. Further to this, the smartphone users, they are growing. A research says an average smartphone user checks his phone at least 100 times a day. Now, here's a great potential that we want to bank on. The consumer is evolving. And with so many options in the market, there's a shift of shopping behavior. The time to transition from multi-channel or single retail channel to omni-channel is now. In the given scenario, we were asked to choose an existing firm to model our business on, that is the omni-channel strategy. We chose Shoppers Stop. Shoppers Stop is a leading department store in India and clearly has an early mover advantage. It has a robust loyalty program and positions itself between aspirational and bridge to luxury market segment. Currently, only 2% of its sales are through their e-commerce portal. They value innovation and have the capital to back an omni-channel strategy. Now, moving on to our customer, as you can see, we begin from here, that's the top of the slide. We want to delight our customer by keeping her involved and by making her shopping experience seamless across the channels. Our omni-channel strategy makes it possible for the retailer to send her notifications on the messages. And if she happens to be in the vicinity of the store, there are more chances that she'll be converted to a potential walk-in. She checks into the store by scanning her QR code on her app, which has a unique customer ID. She's delighted when she's ushered to the interactive trial room, which already has her choice of items ready for trial from her digital cart. She can even share her look on the social media, both privately or publicly, and get an opinion of her friends. While she browses through the store, she's intimated about the available offers and the new product launches in the categories of her interest through the use of beacon technology. She can use the self-checkout kiosk to avoid long queues. Even when she leaves the store, the retailer can keep her engaged. She sends product recommendations based on her previous purchases. We make it easy for her to switch between the mobile app, the e-commerce website, and the brick-and-mortar store. We want her to prefer shopping with the same retailer on all the channels. That's loyalty at another level. Let's consider each of these aspects that we have talked about in the slide and brief you on how we aim to achieve this and get the retailer most out of it. Remember, we just told you how our notification can be treated as a potential walk-in. Well, we aim to achieve this through geofencing techniques, where if the consumer is in the vicinity of the store, relevant messages can be sent to the customer. I'm sure you were wondering where and how relevance comes into picture. Well, we figured out that if we have a robust loyalty program with the offline past shopping data, B, a link to the customer's social media profile, and C, the third-party data, it can be fruitfully used to create a 360-degree unique profile for our customer. And now, this can be used strategically to personalize the shopping experience of our customers. Now, once our customer is inside the store, we incentivize her to scan the QR code by either providing an additional loyalty points or giving her exclusive offers. The incentive not only gives the retailer an additional data point which it can bank upon, but also increases store walk-ins, thus increasing the probability of conversion. Once the sales staff knows that the particular customer is inside the store, that is through the QR code scanning, the items existing in the digital card of the customer, which she had put through either the smartphone app or the website, are moved into the interactive trial room, and that's where she is moved. Moving on to the interactive trial room, the customer is already delighted with all the attention that she is getting. The interactive trial room has two parts. One is the traditional trial room that we all know about, and the other part is technologically enabled, where the customer has access to a lot of features, say the mood light simulator, which will allow the consumer to change the lightings of the environment and judge what the dress would look like in a certain kind of environment, say daylight or office or in a party. An interactive screen, which would suggest coordinates that would go along with what she just purchased. This will also be enabled with features to share the look with a friend, through either through pictures or a video call, where suggestions can be made. The customer would also be able to call the sales rep through a click of a button, and it can be used to either usher in more pieces or to get the checked out. The interaction with friend virtually was an attempt to keep the customer engaged. As a customer encourages her friends to download the smartphone app, in order to make such an interaction possible, she's actually building a community for the retailer. The members of this community will further act as advocates of the retailer, and there will be strong word of mouth retailing, that is marketing. We also aim to do contest-based campaigns, which too will keep our customers involved, and that will be a part of our marketing strategy too. While still in the store, the customer is sent alerts regarding relevant product categories. This feature can be used to either push sales in private labels, which have higher margin, increase penetration in the newer categories, which the customer hasn't purchased yet, or inform customers about promotions currently going on in the other parts of the store. Imagine a world where there are no queues. We feel that the last point of the sales that is made, that is the checkout counters, leave a bad taste with the consumers. The solution is the self-checkout kiosks. We give an option to the customer to pay in-store and get it delivered at home, or pay online and collect it in the store. The self-checkout kiosk thing will also give less time to the consumer to change their minds. If they like something, they'll buy it. Even when the consumer leaves the store, they will be sent notifications and reminded about the ongoing promotions and the items on the wish list. And we can't miss mentioning the abandoned carts, which have a huge potential in not only increasing sales, but also understanding the price sensitivity of the customer. Further to this, omnichannel gives us immense opportunity to build lasting relationships and hence loyalty through the relationship marketing. Moving on to the assortment and pricing strategy, we suggest a mix of external and internal labels to be offered at the store, the website, and the smartphone app. While the non-exclusive external brands will drive the walk-ins in the store and the visits online, the spillover effect will ensure private label sales, which will give us the higher margins. We plan to follow price matching with an aim to minimize the downsides of the showrooming effect. The exclusive external labels and the private labels will ensure that the margin losses due to price matching is minimized. While the store will carry an assortment as per the regional taste, the global saleable inventory would be visible to the customer on the website and the mobile app in different pools of delivery dates based on the availability location. The sales associates in the store will also have an access to inventory information on their PDAs. And if they recommend sales of products online, they will be incentivized, further increasing our sales. We also suggest sourcing a marginal percentage of the assortment locally to give a local flavor on the lines of corporate social responsibility. Implementation of our omnichannel strategy will call for an organizational training. We say we split this training in three parts. That is the training of sales representatives, which would include inventory management training, how they interact with the system, interactive trial rooms, PDAs, and the self-checkout kiosks. The social media managers and customer representatives will be trained with complaint and query handling, and marketing and content development team will be given a training on message consistency and driving traffic across channels. Our plan is to implement the omnichannel strategy over 5 years in 4 phases. In the first phase, we invest in ERP systems, build e-commerce capabilities, refurbish 20 stores to build interactive trial rooms, sell checkout kiosks, address the training needs of these stores, launch a PR campaign to an omnichannel capability. This phase will require intensive capital expenditure. This is a test and run phase for us, which will act like a launch pad for the forthcoming journey. In the second phase, we cover another 20 stores and revisit the business plan for necessary changes, from the reaction of the customers, of course. In the third phase, we complete the implementation with all the stores converted to the smart stores. And then we improve continuously, moving to an augmented reality stores. And here is the financial implication of the whole plan. We get higher margins from the revised assortment mix of private and external labels. We get an increase in sales through an increase in connect with the customers and improving their shopping experience, and thus building loyalty across channels for the retailer. We have made our assumptions, which are detailed in the business plan that we have submitted, and found out that we can achieve a positive net present value of 291 crores in rupees. It's a win-win situation. The retailer makes more profit and the customer is happy. Thank you.
Two quick observations. The first one is that good strategy, you stuck to it, you didn't talk, you let her speak, so that was great. The part that wasn't is that you didn't speak at all, so the other person, so you still have two minutes and 40 seconds to go, so you want to add something? Not right now? Okay, and the second one was that, so Tommy Hilfiger also retails from Shopper Stop?
Yes.
And you didn't have any part of that, maybe even just a photograph of that, and you could have at least got equal brownie points. So that part may just go against you. But other than that, great. So I have questions from the jury. As I'm part of it, I'm going to take the first one this time, right? The part that I was intrigued by right in the beginning was you said Shopper Stop, all the great numbers, and then you said a very small percentage of this is online. I thought a lot of this emphasis would be how to make sure that the online numbers dramatically change. But most of your strategy was what happens in and around the actual store, which Shopper Stop is already pretty good at. You could take it to the next level. Why no emphasis at all on the online part, which is already way too small?
We did not emphasize a lot on online in this presentation because, like, there's already ongoing work on their website. And, like, when we started working on this case, we clicked on the website. It was okay. And a few days later, when we got shortlisted and yay, let's make it more finer and let's make it more crisper, and we saw their website, it was even better. So they're already working towards it.
Okay.
And if you want to consider how we want to, like, say, make our customer shop there, the whole strategy applies in all the channels. The assortment that will get the people to come to the, like, visit the website, that is the thing. And then they also increase their margin percentage through private labels and exclusive brands. An online strategy would remain same as the brick and mortar strategy, except the marketing will be done differently, which Ankita can brief you on.
Okay.
Apart from the marketing, I would actually also like to add that they, at present, they do not sell through their mobile apps. So that is what we also covered in our roadmap. The first year would be, a primary focus would be on actually getting the app up and running. And then the marketing activities, all the marketing activities that we planned are actually aimed at increasing sales on all three channels, across all channels, basically. It's not just the brick and mortar stores.
But a lot of the technology and the usage was for people that are physically around.
So
that was actually mainly your thrust of it all. And a huge number, which is very, had a huge shortfall, was online is really low. So I didn't see that emphasis.
Another point to add, in India, overall, the online sales is 1%. And Shopper Stop is at 2%.
Okay. All right. I'm just saying off the total percentage. Rajiv, okay, great.
I think they get some brownie points. We are tech partners to Shopper Stop and they praise their website.
Okay. You guys have really studied the jury well. Imagine how the strategy would have failed if the two of you had not made it today. Okay. All right. So do we have a question? One more from the jury?
Just one question, which is you've talked about in-store technology. And you also mentioned in the Q&A about the fact that there's something being done online.
Right.
How do you see this being managed organizationally? Do you expect that there would be two organizations managing these two channels, or do you expect a single organization?
So essentially, the idea about omni-channel is that we want to build on our existing capabilities. Although we have laid out the plan so that it will give an omni-channel experience, it will involve that we train the organization, and we have to keep in mind the objectives of the two, the offline stores and then online store together, which means that we can't have two disconnected leadership running it. So essentially, the leadership should be welcoming in order to incorporate, welcome the new ideas that younger generation or it can learn from the more advanced markets like US and UK, where it has already been established. However, we have to maintain the traditional ways of business. So essentially, in order to answer your question, it is like it will be in one organization. It will have two different leads, but it will require a lot of coordination among them.
You know, we made a pact, you broke the rule. Yeah? You're not supposed to talk today,
okay.
Right? But anyway, no minus points for that, right? One question from the audience. Okay, there we go. No, we can't hear you. Now we can, yes.
Hello, this is Likun from ITM Business School. You just mentioned about augmented reality in your presentation.
Yes.
Can you please elaborate it, because this is the first time I'm hearing you're using it into the retail segment. Can you please tell me something about that?
Yeah. So augmented reality store is something, it is more of a futuristic view. Right now it is being developed, it hasn't been in practice. So what it entails is when you go into a store, there is a feel-good factor. You try on things and look at like, how will that particular thing look on you? So we have to move the same experience online, which will effectively enable a customer to have that experience while he's not in store. So it is something like you're browsing on your app or you're browsing on internet, but you're having something very similar. So it is augmented reality, although it is you're viewing it on a screen, but you're getting a feel that it is actually a reality. It is in design phase. And hence, since we had to come up with a 5-year roadmap plan, this is something we believe that if, and practical too, that if you really invest in this technology, this is going to be a big thing in future.
So it includes things like digital mirrors, endless aisles. So endless aisles is basically a concept where if a particular product is not there in the store, you can still go through the interactive tools such as an iPad or any screen and search for those products if it's there in the actual inventory. Digital mirror is when you can actually look at yourself, how you look in a particular product. You want to change the color, you want to change, you want to try accessories with it, try a bag with it, that kind of stuff. That is augmented reality.
Okay, great. I think that's pretty much it. Thank you very much. Let's give them a big hand. Very well presented. Thank you. Come. So that then was the second team. Thank you. Thank you very much. So like I said, from the 300 teams that presented, that was finalist number two. Now time for the last of them all. Of course, absolutely not the least of them all. The three students from Wellinkers will now be presenting their plan. Finalist number three, Wellinkers. Give them a big hand, please. Come.
So good evening, everyone. So every morning when you get up with an emotion or you have a personality in your mind. And when you go off to sleep, you have the similar personality. And we say it is an emotion which is out there. And from this emotion, we created Tripti. Myself, Rahul Sharma, Gaurav Dubey, and Priyanka Lonawat came up with an idea of connecting this emotion, what we call it as God. So if we do the market analysis as a whole, the Indian retail industry stands around 31 trillion rupees as of around 2 weeks back, but today if you see the dollar cost, it's around 39 trillion as a whole. And if in that segment, if we see the organized retail which we can target, would be around 50 billion rupees of the puja industry, which is completely untapped as of now in an organized segment. Next is basically, if you want to develop a business plan, you look for pain points which people are facing nowadays. So we went about asking people, what are the difficulties which they are facing? And in the retail store segment, as well as the online format. So retail, they said, there's no home delivery, parking space constraints, unorganized marketers out there. They can't find standardization of products. If they like a product in somebody's house, they can't find it in the shop, which is out there. And in the online segments, there are quality issues, as well as limited number of online stores are there, which caters to this industry as a specific. Then finally, we went around asking people, like, what do they really want? What are the issues they are facing? How they feel they'll tackle these things in future or in the present day context? So there are aged people who want their kids to be religious. Continuously, we can't connect youth to this industry, or what we can say, people nowadays don't find time to do puja. Like if we see youngsters out there, they are very busy with their schedule. They don't find to do or to indulge in these practices which their parents believe or the grandparents believe in. Then we move on to the opportunity spaces. So it's like you go out there, you ask people what they basically desire, what are their specifications and needs, and you try to connect it to your product finally. And ultimately, we boiled down to these and listed them based on the importance and the factors which they want to be included in the product offerings based on regionality, as well as the nature of the things which they are focusing on or doing puja to related to certain kind of god, what kind of product they want finally. We listed down that. And then based on this, we developed three personas, because it's very important to identify to whom you're going to sell, what you're going to sell, and how you're going to sell. So for that, you need to know your consumer. So different kinds of consumer listings, under which different demographics and psychographics were considered, and age groups and factors were considered, and three personas were made based on that. Finally, coming down to the business model, what Tripti is, what it stands for, how it will go on. So first, we are trying to connect the rural artisans, because they can build up a lot of things, because they are more aware about the regionality of these products. Because as we know, India is a diverse country. We had around more than 33 million gods. We need to cater to each and every need of that consumer which is out there. So our sourcing agent goes to the dealer and connect them. Then finally, we have sourcing agents to show products, designers approval, and we develop samples based on that. Then our designers finalize, because standardization of product is very important if we want to cater to each and every person. Then finally, the product comes to our warehouse, then it finally goes to Tripti store, and then finally we connect with the consumer. Then we move on to the extended business model. What are the pain points which people are facing? So every day when you do puja, you collect things in your houses and it stays there for months, 3 months, or even years. So how to connect those dots and link it? So we thought of a renewable cycle which we can generate. So we have cardboards, we have incense sticks through which we can make different kinds of products. So we even try to channelize that. So we'll have a Tripti store in the center. We'll have a recycling unit, as well as the rural distribution center through which we'll be connecting it. We'll have an omni-channel access where we'll be connecting our store to people. And one of the main points is the temple trunk delivery service. So continuously we'll be indulging with a customer to delivery of temple trunk weekly, which will be explained in the later on slides. Now coming down, if you want to get into the business, you want to develop a pure concrete marketing strategy. So how do you go about developing that marketing strategy? To develop that marketing strategy, you need to know what are the touch points of your consumer. So for that, we developed a journey map so as to come down with a concrete marketing strategy to make an impact, and a very powerful impact among our consumers. Business canvas strategy is a tool which we utilized so as to connect the each and every dot of the business. So how a business is described, how it will run through, what are the pivoting tools which will help it in developing. So first are the value propositions and the customer segments. So value propositions will be the offerings based by Tripti as a whole, and customer segments to whom we'll be catering to. Next are the key partners. For our retail channel, we want these partners to develop standardized products and to cater to their needs and develop a good logistic. We need to have a good partnership with them. Next come the key activities and the key resources. Key activities are the things which a store will do to cater to the needs, and key resources are the employabilities and the various tools and structures which we'll be using as a whole. Next is the customer relations and channels. Customer relations will be through personal, convenience, and online, and channels are the structured ways through which we'll be handling this. And finally is the cost structure and the revenue structure, because ultimately the driving force behind any business is the cost and the revenue. And through this, we develop our business canvas strategy, where you can see the left-hand side columns, the four columns are the back-end, whereas customer relations, channels, and customer segments are the front-end part of it. And finally, you can see that the bottom, the cost structure as well as the revenue structure. So it completely formulates what the business canvas strategy looks like and how we will go about our business. Next are the products offerings. So we'll have two kinds of product offerings. One will be the core offering and other will be the augmented offerings. So core offerings relates to the regional products. As I told you that India is a diverse country, we need to cater to each and every individual out there. So we need to have regional products. There will be temple trunk, customized temples, because we as people develop new homes, we want it to be according to our needs. It should means we like different things. We like innovative products which are out there. And augmented offerings will be the service offerings, will be like pandit service, religious portfolio building, and recycling. So we map down what are the people who will be building it, building our products, who will be the manufacturers, wholesalers. So we mapped it down, and we, based on that, we tried to locate our stores as well as the distribution centers to connect it. Business risk. Every business involves risk. So few of our risks are challenges to maintain the standardization of the products, because that's one of the most important part of it. Supply chain and logistics, because every time a person requires a certain kind of product, if you're not able to deliver him in time, then it's a failure for us. And there are legal risks associated with that even. Market we target. So we have divided our strategy into three phases. So first phase includes four stores. That is Mumbai and Delhi. So we are catering to the Hindu population out there, because we feel these people will come and buy from our stores because their values are associated with that. So then we boil down to the phase two, where we come up with total of 4 + 6, 10 stores, and finally 16 stores as a whole. Demand analysis was done based on the population which is present out there. And finally, we thought around 2.5% of the innovators will be there who will try to come and buy products from our stores in the starting, as we build up on our marketing strategy and try to create a push out there. Financials, so we expect a threefold growth along the sales, as we can see that. We feel that the net income will rise to around 7.6, whereas we can see the break even can come around 1.13 crores at the end of our first year. Through annual self-financing growth rate, we try to finance our business continuously, and we'll have a sustainable growth rate of around 23% as a whole. Competitors. So as we see, there are no retail stores as such in India which are organized as a whole for these products. There are only online stores which are present out there, which can be a challenge for us in certain way when we look at the omni-channel side part of it. So we found out only three main companies which are catering to these kind of stuff. Layout. So we build up a layout, what kind of layout we'll have for our stores, because we want to build a customer interaction with the product. So we have a roaming space around it. A customer can touch and feel the product and then buy it, because ultimately it's about the value which we try to propagate through this. And this is the 3D layout for that. Marketing campaign is one of the most important things. So we start with 2 weeks pre-launch. So we'll have channels like newspaper jackets, through radios. We'll try to create teasers and short ads. Then it will increase the curiosity. Then 1 week pre-launch, like familiarizing the target audience about the concept of the business, how it will be, what it will be, where it will be, what kind of products we'll be giving. And then finally, the launch, creating a high impulse urge among these people to buy the products. So what are the innovative elements? Because this is what the customer finally buys through a retail store. That's the innovation which you can offer. So first is the recyclability part of it, where we can recycle their goods, because people we see in towns, they throw whatever they collect near the trees. So why can't we utilize them and pay them certain kind of incentives through coupons and they come and buy to our stores? Second will be the rural artisans. We want to generate employment as well. So we'll be training rural artisans based on the products and the variety of categories we want to cater to, so we can train them and they can develop for us. Next is the temple trunk. So we have got a demo of this temple trunk. So we, due to the auspicious occasion of Ganesh Chaturthi tomorrow, so what we are doing a beta testing tomorrow as such. So we'll be delivering it to around 15 households. So this solves the problem of the people in Bombay, because we see there are a lot of atmospheric changes, and due to which whatever products they try to bring in bulk, those things get spoiled. So we try to deliver it on a weekly basis. So this is a beta testing phase which we are doing tomorrow. And finally is a portfolio. So every customer wants a personal engagement. So what we do, we build up a personal portfolio for that individual. He gives his date of birth to us, the place where he's born, and we build it up. Like how he has to do puja at home, or a Diwali, or a Holi, what kind of things he has to do. Because in nuclear families, we ultimately don't want Pandit to involve with us, so we have less time to. So we have everything in that book, which will be a personalized interaction as a whole. Now the omni-channel presence, that is through app, website, interactive panel, retail chain, home delivery, and umbrella marketing. Yeah. So under umbrella marketing, we are catering to all kind of products which are there under the brand of Tripti. Because for many people, brand is important and the quality of product is very important. So under this brand, we try to sell each and every product which is out there based on the regionalities. We have website as well as app so that customer can continuously engage with us 24/7. So suppose if in a busy day, he comes late after 9 o'clock and he wants the product delivery early morning. So what does he do? Where does he go? Because stores are closed. So he puts an online order, our guy comes and delivers it early morning. That gives him a personal space out there and personal interaction with a store as well. Next, finally, is the tree of Tripti. So how do we deal with the organization structure of a whole process? So our main features are the product, retail, and design, through which we end extract or emerge out into various things, and finally we tap various features and we try to expand as a whole when we move on with a business and a plan. And may you live in interesting times. Thank you. All
right. So again, time for my two quick observations.
Yeah.
I want to join your team. So the first one is, I really like the part where you said 33 million gods and we have to, you know, cater to all of them. So if you actually get your number of SKUs right for 33 million gods, then that would be the world's largest SKUs ever.
Yeah.
Amazon looks like a small little boy in front of you, for sure. So that, if you can do, amazing. 33 million gods. Even if you have two products per god, that's a serious number of SKUs. And the second one is that the temple trunk that you demonstrated, and you did say the beta is for Bombay. So it's absolutely perfect because the size was absolutely right. But if you do a beta in Delhi, just make it a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
We have real houses there, right? So that would really help, you know, not the little pigeonholes you have here. Okay, so that was really great. The rest I'll leave to the jury. Questions?
So as a consumer, as a youth of puja products, right, what would have delighted me more probably was the content commerce part of it. Where I am more enlightened about what puja to do, when to do, why to do, and then probably linking those products around it, right? So any strategies around that?
Yeah, so we tried building a portfolio. As I explained, a portfolio will cater to your each and every need which is out there. So suppose if you're worshipping a certain kind of god, so we have a date of birth, your place of birth, so build up a portfolio around that god, how you worship, what kind of products you'll use, what kind of products you will be getting from our side, because we are building a customized portfolio for as a whole for you. So it will not be a hassle for you to come to store. It will be like, we have built up a portfolio for you, so we will be delivering it to you before the festival, which is going to come.
Sure, one more question.
Just one question in terms of who do you target as a customer for your business?
Okay.
Can you get somebody else to answer?
Yeah. Through,
use this mic, yeah. Yeah, so our target audience would be the mass audience in India. The Hindu population is what we target.
So that's currently, I think if you look at the last census, it comes to 960 million people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, 80%. So who amongst them? Is it men, women, boys, girls, children, those living in larger cities, those living in rural areas? Who is it that you're specifically targeting?
And I think I am very interested in the age group, because you had two things you said, the old and the aged that are very interested, and the young that don't know anything about this at all. So which one are you really going to go for?
Yeah.
Particularly the elder people who would like their children to pray every day, and the people who are in the corporate world who don't get time to worship every day. So even those will be our target segment.
It's like targeting the influencer, because ultimately it's the influencer who will drive. Like if you as a dad want to drive your children, so you'll get them products. Suppose if we take the example of Temple Trunk, if you give them a small Ganeshji and you get certain goods, so he'll or she'll be interested in doing stuff like, how do we do it, how do we go about it, because it's channelizing. Because we ultimately don't even want our children to do it the wrong way. We've always wanted to do it the right way. So it's about channelizing that. So it will be a connect between you and your child, which we'll be bridging through that.
He's put you as your the target audience. Now, which category you're in, that they'll only tell you. I'm not getting into that one. That's a touchy topic, right? But you're the target audience for sure. One per, all right, we'll get the mic out there.
One small.
It's on.
You guys are much smarter than what I was 14 years back when I was a student. One question, any particular reason you have targeted only Hindu gods? We have Sikhs, Christians and Muslims, and you'll have a larger pie or a larger market if you include all of them in.
Yeah, it's like we are starting up, so we target a larger population which is out there, because ultimately we don't want to cater to certain segment. We are targeting around, if you look at the present stats, it's around 79.8% of the Hindu population. And like we did a demand analysis, if we take around 2.5% of that population, if they even come to our store, it will be a huge success for us. Ultimately, we are driving it. We want to drive a different culture, because ultimately what we are dealing with is the values which are out there in the market, which are there with inside the people, those emotions. So we are trying to cater to that, and we are trying to push that. As a whole. So
also,
that's why
the rest of it is that out of the 33 million gods, 99.9% are from our distributor in the Hindu. So they're getting that percentage right. I can only sure. Okay, also highest consumption items also come from the Hindu gods. Okay, so that then is your presentation. Very well presented, very well answered. Give them a big hand, please.